As we heard, you have re-recorded Castles in the Air from your very first album, Tapestry. What is the main reason to do a 12-year-old song again?
Well, I thought it was a song that should have wider popularity. And I knew all my my fans who come to see the concerts always thought that that song was one of my best songs. And since it's kind of hard to get my first record, I felt, why not? So we went to Nashville, and I think we made a better, more mature recording of the song.
Your European tour is this time only promotional. You're not giving any concerts. Why is that?
Well, I'm going now to do some promotion for 3 weeks in about 5 countries. And then I'm starting a 2-month tour. 1 month in England, Ireland, Scotland, and then I will probably go to Scandinavia. I will go to Germany, France. So that'll be 6 or 7, maybe 8 weeks of constant concert work.
Yeah. Talking about your latest album, Believers. After listening its title track many times, I'm still not sure if it's a pessimistic or an optimistic song.
Well, I'm an idealist without illusions, which means I guess I'm an optimistic person in a pessimistic world. And the song really says that no matter how much money you have, if you don't believe in something, you can't have happiness. So it goes... All the gold can't find no peace of mind in a world that don't believe in nothing anymore. That's the chorus of it.
Yeah. Can we talk about your older albums now?
Sure.
Yeah. Playing Favorites, which was your 4th LP, was an album of diverse material. You were performing familiar folk and country tunes, none of them self-composed. To be honest, Don, was that album kind of protest to all those fans who wanted more and more American pies?
Well, I didn't really know what commercial show business was. I was always in music for the art of it. The people that I liked made records for small record companies, and they might make 50 or 60 albums of obscure material. And it didn't matter to me that I had 2 huge worldwide hits under my belt by the time I did that album. Mm-hmm. My goal was still to try and put the kinds of music that I do, whether I write the songs or whether I sing the songs, on records. I didn't really realize I was supposed to be just like Bob Dylan or I was supposed to be just like John Lennon. I didn't know that. I was too naive. Yeah. So in spite of the fact that the album had no songs that I had written on it, 2 songs came off it and were hits, in one in Ireland and one in England. And that, I think, tended to support my popularity in those countries more, because they were... The one that was a hit in England was one called Every Day, which was a Buddy Holly song. And as everybody knows by now, American Pie was dedicated to Buddy Holly and started the Buddy Holly revival, which in turn led to the whole new wave. Gene Vincent, Buddy Holly, Eddie Cochran, all these guys in the 50s are the people that made the music that the new wave groups now copy. But really, those kids didn't even know who Buddy Holly was, I don't think, until American Pie came along, because the disc jockeys on the radio... Buddy Holly revival, which in turn led to the whole new wave. Gene Vincent, Buddy Holly, Eddie Cochran, all these guys in the 50s are the people that made the music that the new wave groups now copy. But really, those kids didn't even know who Buddy Holly was, I don't think, until American Pie came along, because the disc jockeys on the radio stations would play a Buddy Holly tune every time they played American Pie. Now they play American Pie every time someone dies. But the other song was one called The Mountains of Mourne, which became a hit in Ireland. And that had been a famous old song that kids sing And it, you know, it goes, "Oh Mary, this London's a wonderful sight, with people here working by day and by night. They don't sow potatoes, nor barley, nor wheat, but there's gangs of them digging for gold in the street. At least when I asked them, that's what I was told. So I just took a hand at this digging for gold. But for all that I found there, I might as well be in the place where the dark morn sweeps down to the sea." It's a story of an Irishman who goes to England and sees all this stuff going on, this modern society there. And he writes his girlfriend back home in Ireland and says, "Things aren't like they are at home, and I wish I was back home by the mountains of Mourne." Well, that put me over in Ireland forever. And so that album had, that Playing Favorites record had many advantages to me in terms of just my career.
Yeah. American Pie catapulted you to international fame, but unfortunately, the success of that song has tended to overshadow the rest of your career. How do you feel about this song today?
Well, depending on the interviewer, they sometimes say Vincent overshadowed my career, or they say that now that I have made hits of Crying and Since I Don't Have You, that means that I'm not a songwriter anymore. You know, there's always something to be said, no matter what you do. For example, look at Paul McCartney. He's always got to answer questions about the Beatles, no matter how many hits he has, no matter how much work he does as Paul McCartney. If he does an interview, he's got to be asked, well, what was it like to be in the Beatles? Because that's all anybody's interested in. He must, you know, go out of his mind. Yeah. Because basically, it's really not any one song that keeps your career going or that allows you to have an audience. People that have only one song just have one song. They don't have an audience. Yeah. But the audience has to come because they buy your album or maybe buy your albums. And they listen to all the music, and they like your style. So I would say that I'm very thankful that I had two big hits in the beginning of my career, because I never would have gotten to play anywhere but in the United States. And being able to travel, being able to come to countries like Finland and maybe go to the Middle East where I've been, and perhaps someday I'll go to the Far East, I don't know, I think has made me realize how the world is, and also made me see America's place in that more realistically than I would if I was just sitting home inside the walls of the United States and not really getting outside to see how other people live and what they think about us and what we're really doing out here, and which you can't know unless you go there.
Okay, can we have a little bit of American Pie?
Sure. Long, long time ago, I can still remember how that music used to make me smile. And I knew if I had my chance that I could make those people dance. Maybe they'd be happy for a while. February made me shiver. And every paper I deliver, bad news on the doorstep. I couldn't take one more step. I can't remember if I cried when I read about his widowed bride, but something touched me deep inside the day the music died. So bye-bye, Miss American Pie. Drove my Chevy to the levee, but the levee was dry. Them good old boys are drinking whiskey and rye, singing, "This'll be the day that I die. This'll be the day that I die." Did you write the book of love, and do you have faith in God above? If the Bible tells you so, now do you rock and roll? Can music save your mortal soul? And Can you teach me how to dance real slow? Well, I know that you're in love with him, 'cause I saw you dancing in the gym while you both kicked off your shoes. Man, I dig those rhythm and blues. I was a lonely teenage drunken buck with a pink carnation and a pickup truck. But I knew I was out of luck today. The music died.
I don't know about Immortal Soul, but I think that song will be immortal. You have recorded 9 albums, is that right?
Yeah.
Which one is your own favorite?
Well, I like them all. And I put a lot into them. I put my whole life into those records because I knew they'd be around a long time. In fact, you were mentioning the Don McLean record, the third one. And we were just hearing it over there when I came in, and I hadn't heard it in about 8 years because I don't listen to my own records. And I liked it. I liked what I heard. Which is amazing. I mean, most of the time you hear things that you did a long time ago and you get a little sick.
What do you think about the cover versions of your songs, like Perry Como's And I Love You So?
Well, there have been covers of... the big hit was And I Love You So. Then there was a cover version of Winter Wood, and there was cover versions of Empty Chairs, and there's been the Castles in the Air or two. There's been... I think about 3 or 4. There's Wonderful Baby, several others. And, I have him to thank, really, for proving to the public and to the industry that I was a really commercial songwriter, that I could write songs that were useful, you know, and part of pop music. Because I think before that, it was just... I was kind of a maverick. I wasn't really in the mainstream, and I never really was understood by my record companies. I think for the most part they expected another American Pie, or if Vincent was hot, they want another Vincent, or if Crying made it, they want another Crying. You know, do every Roy Orbison song in the book. They're not very creative most of the time. So we were not... I must say that's not true for my record company overseas. EMI was very good to me. And United Artists is very good over here because I think they have a broader outlook toward music. In America, it's strictly the commercial thing of the moment, nothing else. And I think that is basically what's killing art, is that people who might have many, many more wonderful things to sing about and write about are really restricted from doing that. And then they get into the trap of making lots of money. And they realize the money's going to stop if they go and try to do things that they want to do for artistic reasons. So basically, my wants have always been pretty small. I mean, I don't wear a tuxedo and I don't drive around in a Cadillac, so I don't really have to worry about it. And still, I have done much better than I ever thought I would. I mean, I had no idea that the music business could be so good to me, and it was, and the audiences have been great too. So I really have him to thank for improving my reputation as a songwriter.
Okay, thank you very much, John, and welcome back to Finland very soon.
Thank you. I hope to come here and sing for you.